You would please take your copies of God's Word and join me in the book of Colossians, chapter 3. Colossians, chapter 3. We'll begin reading at verse 18. And read down to verse 21. Colossians 3 and verse 18. Wives, submit to your husbands as is fitting in the Lord. Husbands, love your wives and do not be harsh with them. Children, obey your parents in everything, for this pleases the Lord. Fathers, do not provoke your children, lest they become discouraged. Well, let's again look to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have ordained these worship services, and so we come to you today seeking to do your will, the things that please you. Father, we believe that you've given your word for us, an ancient document, and yet very relevant to the 21st century, because you are God, you are always the same, and your word is true and faithful. Heavenly Father, how we cry out to you for the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the one whom Jesus promised to send us, the one who is said to take the things of Christ and make them known to us. And so we pray even this morning that these words of an inspired apostle of Christ might be brought to our minds with understanding and to our wills with grace, that we might be people who desire above all things to do what you tell us to do. Oh, Father, we know that we're weak and we're sinful. Like sheep, we often go astray. Father, we pray that by your Spirit, you'd bring us back to walk in those paths of righteousness that please you. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As we make our way through this section of Paul's letter to the Colossian church, we see it becomes very clear that Christ wants Christian families to be places where the gospel shines brightly. The message of a redeeming and transforming Savior is not to be limited to the gatherings of the church. The plan of God for this glorious good news is that it should pervade every corner of our lives. Family relationships are fundamental to living in this world. And if the gospel is to shine anywhere, it should be right here in the midst of these family relationships. Now we're looking at the second of three pairs that Paul is addressing. First, there was wives and husbands. Now it's children and their parents. And here in verse 21, specifically, fathers. Last week we considered what God would say to children, what the major duty of children is in their home. And we discovered again, very plainly, very simply, Paul calls children living in Christian families to obedience to their parents. But what about the parents? What does God expect of them? How is the gospel to impact their parenting? Well, here in verse 21, we find Paul focusing on the fathers. It's not that mothers are unimportant. When children are to obey, they're to obey both fathers and mothers. Even Proverbs reminds us of the importance of mothers in the raising of children. But here the apostle is putting the focus on the man as the one who bears ultimate responsibility for relationships in the home. It's the father that God has placed as the head of the home. The exercise of authority is ultimately his, as well as the responsibility for how those relationships work out. So, men, we're coming back to you again this morning. We've already considered your relationship to your wife. Now it's your relationship with your children and what God expects. The spotlight of God's Word is often an uncomfortable place to be in. The world wants to run and hide from it. They don't want the truth shining on their lives because they know it reveals their sins. May we be willing to have the full light of God's Word shine upon us. There will no doubt be sins to confess and forsake, but also patterns of behavior to learn that ultimately we might be like our great example, our Father in heaven. So let's begin this morning, as we often have, by considering the major duty of fathers. The major duty of fathers. Now, when you look at Paul's words here, particularly in verse 21, you can see that God's word to fathers is significantly different from all of the instructions that precede it. They have all been positive. Wives, submit. Husbands, love. Children, obey. But now this word to fathers is negative. Fathers, do not provoke your children. It obviously stands in stark contrast to everything that has gone before. Now, I'm using the same kind of language that has described the previous instructions being the major duty. There may be other things that wives are to do, but primarily they're to submit to their husbands. There are lots of things for husbands to do, but primarily they're to love their wives. There are many things for children to do in the home, but primarily they're to obey their parents. So it must be very important that in addressing fathers, Paul gives their major duty in this negative language. Don't provoke your children. When you think of a negative like that, you might be tempted to include that this shouldn't be considered to be the major duty of a father's parenting. It might be better identified as a sort of minor adjustment to their parenting practice, something that they should avoid. But Paul has nothing else to say to fathers. This is to be considered their major duty. When they consider their relationship with their children, this is to be what is at the forefront of their minds. Don't provoke your children. So what do Paul's words mean here? What is it to provoke your children? The word translated here in the ESV, provoke, means to literally stir up something or to stimulate someone. It can mean to arouse someone to certain feelings or actions. And it can be used in Scripture in both a positive and a negative way. For instance, in 2 Corinthians 9, when Paul is exhorting the church there about the offering being taken up for the poor believers in Jerusalem, he speaks of the zeal of the Christians in Corinth and how it's provoked Christians in other places to participate in the offering. He says, your zeal has stirred up most of them. Or your zeal has provoked them to participate in the offering. In Hebrews 10:24, when the writer is speaking to the church about the responsibilities of membership in a local church, he says, this is one thing we're to be doing, provoking one another to love and good works. And so here's this idea of stirring up somebody else, arousing someone else in a positive way. But usually we think of this word, this action, in the negative. For instance, the parallel text to Colossians 3:21, in Ephesians chapter 6, where Paul says almost the identical thing, he adds these words, fathers, do not provoke your children to anger. Obviously, using the word in a negative sense. Paul is saying to fathers, there is this negative picture of a child being irritated by his father, becoming exasperated, frustrated. The father, in the exercise of his authority in the home, has stirred up the child, and the end result is something that is not good. Well, the Apostle Paul here, both by the language he has chosen and the emphasis he has given, has laid his finger on a major problem in men's parenting. Men, whether we're aware of it or not, we have a tendency to provoke our children to wrong responses. That's why I believe Paul is making this the major focus of instructions to fathers. When we see our children exhibiting sinful attitudes in the home, our knee-jerk reaction is to blame them and then to punish them. But Paul exhorts fathers to begin by looking at themselves. Have I provoked this anger? Have I been the cause of their frustration? Are they acting out because of me? If you are a man with true Christian humility, you will be willing to look at yourselves. You will be crying out to God, have I done this? Am I the cause of my child's sinful response? You may even be willing to ask your wife for her assessment. Be humble enough to listen and change where necessary. This isn't bowing to modern thinking about parenting. This is the voice of an inspired apostle of the Lord Jesus. And it struck me, as Mike was reading that text from Matthew, that here is an application of that principle about having a critical spirit. When it's so easy to see the sins in others, instead of seeing the sins in yourself. And Paul here, in essence, would say to us as fathers, okay, you see your children doing something wrong. Are you willing to first look at yourself and say, am I the cause of this? Have I provoked my child to a sinful response? Question, how can a father provoke his children? Paul doesn't give us a description here. He doesn't enlarge. He simply gives us the instructions. Don't provoke your children. So it's left to us to look at life and ask the question, how may a father provoke his children? Obviously, I'm not going to give you an exhaustive list. I think we'd be here most of the day. And I certainly am far from being infinite in my understanding. But I think that what I want to mention is important and can help a man to examine his leadership in his family. So how can a father provoke his children? Well, I think a father can do this by having a domineering attitude. Now, I believe that God has made men to be the head of their home. That applies to both the marriage relationship and the parental relationship. But often men abuse that great responsibility by their attitude or words and actions. They can act in the family as though they were kings, where everyone else is meant to bow down to them and serve their needs. But that is not how Jesus taught us to exercise authority. A leader must learn to be a servant. He must be looking out for the good of everyone that God has placed under him. The picture of a husband and father arriving home at night from work, sitting down in his easy chair, opening the paper to read it, and barking orders to his wife and his children, that's not the picture that Jesus wants in our homes. Such a domineering attitude will alienate family members from him. I believe it will provoke his children. A second way in which fathers may do this in their home, provoke their children, is by the abuse of discipline. The abuse of discipline. Now, if you were here for our parenting series a few years ago, you will know that I believe in parents disciplining their children. As Christians, we should not be ashamed of biblical texts that speak very clearly of discipline. For instance, Proverbs 13:24. Whoever spares the rod hates his son, but he who loves him is diligent to discipline him. We should not be ashamed of that. That's God's word. Or Proverbs 23:13-14. Do not withhold discipline from a child. If you strike him with a rod, he will not die. If you strike him with a rod, you will save his soul from Sheol. Now, I really don't care what any court in Canada says, or what any government says, or any sociologist or psychologist says. That's the wisdom of God. And that's what we need to be practicing in our homes. We should not be ashamed of that at all. But there can be an abuse of discipline that provokes your children to sinful responses. For instance, excessive discipline that fails to maintain a balance of encouragement and praise in the home. Where a father is just always correcting, always seeing what is wrong, always calling a child on the carpet, so to speak. And there's just discipline, 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 spanking, 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 and it just goes on and on and on. That kind of parenting, that kind of fathering is going to provoke children to anger. I remember one time being a guest in a home for several days. I was away at a conference, and so I'd been put up in a home. And this home had two teenage boys in it. And I felt so bad for those boys. Didn't seem like they could do anything right. They were always being spoken down to. I almost bristled at the way that the father spoke to the sons over and over again. Children are going to be angry. They're going to be provoked when that's the attitude that emanates in the home and is prominent in all of the relationships. So excessive discipline. But then inconsistent discipline, where one day dad is a terror and the next day you can get away with anything. That's a temptation in parenting, especially when we're tired. So one day we see the kids do what is wrong. We're right on top of them. We're disciplining them. We're calling them to account. But the next day we're tired and maybe feeling a little bit lazy, and so we just let them get away with murder. It happens all the time in homes, inconsistent discipline. And that is going to provoke your children, because they say, okay, today, what's it going to be? Am I going to be in trouble, or am I off the hook? They don't know where the guidelines, where the boundaries are. As well as excessive and inconsistent discipline, the absence of discipline, where the child is always being spoiled in order to gain his favor. You know, that's become a sort of modern thinking in parenting. Your child has to be your best friend, and so you're out to curry their favor all the time. That often leads to the absence of discipline, and so the child's behavior becomes unruly, and as a result, they're often provoked to sinful responses. The perversion of biblical discipline can provoke your children. A third area, I've already mentioned this, but just focus on it for a moment. Constant fault finding. Constant fault finding. Now, parents have the responsibility to know their children and to know what's going on in their lives. And we have the task of encouraging them to do what is right and warning them about what is wrong. Part of parental duty is correction. While our children are under our authority, we must make sure that they do not go astray. But it's easy for the work of correction to become constant fault-finding. I'm not sure what the reason is. Maybe it's because it's always easier to see someone else's sin, like Jesus says in Matthew 7. But this work of correction can become a constant focus on the sins and mistakes of your children. And it's easy for that to slide into derogatory words like stupid, idiot. Won't you ever learn? Don't you know? Oh, brethren, words like that should not be found in our home. You may often find them out in the world when you listen to worldly fathers addressing their children. But may those kinds of words never be found on your lips. That kind of parenting can crush children. And so the necessity of Paul's additional words, don't provoke your children lest they become discouraged. Under that kind of parenting, it's easy for children to lose heart, to want to give up, to wonder, what's the use? Dad is never going to be pleased. If a father is doing his job, he's going to seek to encourage his children, to build them up instead of tearing them down all the time. A father is not ultimately responsible because we can't change the hearts of our children. But when there is something wrong, we have to stop and ask the question, am I the problem? Have I been provoking my children? Are they discouraged because of me? This is the major responsibility of a father in relation to his children. Now let's go on, secondly, to ask an important question. How is such a parenting pattern to be avoided? How is such a parenting pattern to be avoided? This is obviously a very practical question. Here's Paul instructing the various members of the family. He comes to fathers. He outlines this major duty. Don't provoke your children. So how is this to be avoided? Obviously, an important question. And as I pondered this question and how we should respond to it, because Paul doesn't take it up here, he doesn't give us an answer here. Just thinking through the Bible as a whole, it came to my mind the benefit of theology in informing our practice. Now, at first, that might think, we might think, well, that's not where to go. If I'm answering this practical question, how do I avoid provoking my children? My first thought is not, I need to turn to my theology textbook and get the answer. But that's exactly where we need to go, especially if our theology book is a biblical book and it's going to help us to understand the teaching of the Word of God. Where's the best place to learn parenting? Where's the best place to learn parenting? It's by keeping your eyes focused on the best Father. And that's God the Father in heaven. The Scriptures are filled with opportunities to view God in His role as a Father. And it's as we fix our eyes on Him in His fathering that we're going to learn how to avoid provoking our children. One of the best places is in the Gospels, where we seek that unique relationship between God the Father and God the Son. Of course, the story of the birth of Christ gives us a special insight into the delight of God the Father, that His Son would take up this special commission and come into this world to be the Savior. And that angelic chorus who stand in heaven surrounding the throne of God and wait upon God for His bidding, can you imagine Him telling them, I want you to go to Bethlehem and I want you to announce the birth of my Son. And as they came there and sang to the glory of God, it testified to the Father's joy over His Son. Later, when Jesus was grown up and entered into His public ministry through the act of baptism, God the Father sent the Spirit to mark Him out publicly. And with verbal announcement, He proclaimed to people who had gathered the relationship of love which they enjoyed. The miracles which Jesus performed were like a stamp of approval by the Father on the ministry of His Son. And though His suffering and death witnessed a terrible fracture between Father and Son, we know that it was not because of anything that Jesus had done. It was because He had become our sin bearer. Jesus was experiencing what we deserve because of our sin. But the resurrection on the third day was the Father proclaiming His acceptance and His delight of all that the Son had accomplished in life and in death. And then, of course, Jesus' subsequent ascension and exaltation in glory is an ongoing testimony of the Father's love and joy in His Son. So it would be good for us as fathers to look at all of that and say, how can we incorporate that into our fathering in our family? A father might be tempted to say, well, anyone could have done a good job as the father of Jesus because he was a perfect son, and so he never sinned. But thankfully, the Bible is also full of the record of God as Father to sinners, to great sinners. Recently, we were thinking about Abraham and his great failure as a husband. Let's ask this question. Did God, as Abraham's heavenly father, cast him off? When Abraham made such foolish, unwise, sinful choices for his family, did God say at that point, I don't want to have anything more to do with Abraham? Well, obviously not. We know all about God's dealings with Abraham as a father. How he was patient with him. How he was faithful in all of the promises that he made to Abraham. How he had an open and honest relationship with Abraham. When the Lord came down and was on his way to destroy Sodom and Gomorrah, he came to Abraham and thought, shall I do this without revealing to Abraham what I'm going to do? There was abundant provision of all of his needs. Abraham was never in want. There was protection when Abraham was surrounded with enemies. God was a father to Abraham, committed to his son despite his great failures. It's when we keep our eyes fixed on God as our Father that we're going to know how to parent our children and avoid this error of provoking them. So, to be the best father that you can be, it's not that you need to get a whole bunch of books on fathering and read them. That could be helpful and good. The most important thing is to have your eye fixed on your Heavenly Father and be studying Him and be looking through the Scriptures and asking the question, how does God deal with His children? That will help you to be the very best father that you can. And so as a result, you got to be reading the Bible. And you got to be studying God. And you got to be studying the theology of God. What does God tell us about Himself in His fathering of His people? And along with that, you've got to keep your eyes fixed on the Lord Jesus. You remember when our Savior was in the upper room with His disciples, just before He went to the cross, and He was telling them about His departure and how after that He would be going to heaven. And this is the response of one of the disciples, Philip. Philip said to Him, Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. Jesus said to him, have I been with you so long, and you still do not know me, Philip? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, show us the Father? So we open our Bibles, we study the Scriptures, we look at God the Father, but then we also look at Jesus. Because Jesus tells us that as we look at Him, He is a living representation of what God the Father is like. And then we also have this wonderful truth where Jesus spoke of His relationship to the Father in Matthew 11. He said this, all things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal Him. And so Jesus tells us, if you want to know God the Father, you've got to come to me, because I'm the one who makes the Father known. So not only do we have to have our Bibles open, looking at God the Father, not only do we need to be reading through the Gospels and studying the Lord Jesus to see this human demonstration of God the Father, we need to be coming to the Lord Jesus and asking Him, all right, Lord Jesus, You've promised that You're the only one who can really make the Father known. So I want to know the Father. I want to know the Father more. I want to know the Father more, not only for my relationship with Him, but so that I can become a greater Father. Now, as I look out here this morning, there are lots of fathers. And for some of us, the majority of our work of fathering is done. And we might look back over a couple of decades and say, well, the Lord helped me here, but I know I fell down here. And there are no doubt things that you've had to confess to the Lord and ask for His forgiveness. But I know as I look out this morning, there are some men who are actively right now in the middle of this work. How are you going to improve your fathering? How are you going to become a better parent to the glory of God and for the good of your children? Well, we've seen it right here. You're going to need to keep your focus on God the Father every day. And you're going to need to be looking to the Lord Jesus Christ and learning from Him and asking Him, show me the Father. Help me to know the Father more. Help me to understand better from His example how to lead my family. And so is that what you're doing? Are you in the Word every day? Are you praying every day? Are you keeping your focus on God the Father? It's the only way it's going to happen. And the Bible tells us that when we keep our eyes fixed on God, when we keep looking to the Lord Jesus, that's when the work of transformation takes place. It's when we're beholding the Lord in His glory that He, by His Spirit, is going to be changing us to be more like Him. Even when it's not our specific purpose, maybe we're just enjoying communion with the Lord. But when we do that, He's going to be changing us and making us more like Him. And as followers of the Lord Jesus Christ, that's something that we should want more than anything else. Not just for fathering, but for all of life. That we will be changed from glory to glory into the image of the Lord. May God give us grace. May that be our heart's desire to be like Jesus Christ day after day. Let's bow in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank You for these practical instructions that You give in Your Word. Heavenly Father, may we not just listen to them, but may we be people who live them out. Lord, we need Your grace. We need grace to know ourselves. We need grace to recognize our sins. We need Your grace to motivate us and strengthen us to do the things that we need to be doing. Father, would You help all of our fathers? You're the perfect Father. You're the best Father. No one could ever find fault with You. Help our men to keep their eyes fixed on You. Help them to be coming to Christ day after day, to know the Father. Grant our God that in our families, the light of the gospel will shine brightly. The knowledge of God will be known. And there will be a powerful testimony to our children and to the world all around us of what God is like. Father, we ask these things that You would be glorified. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.